Good morning. Good morning. Good morning to you who are joining us online, and welcome to Life in Christ Lutheran Church on this, the 20th Sunday after Pentecost today. It's good to see you. We're glad that you're here. If you haven't already done so, there's a white card just like this in the seat back in front of you. Please take a moment and fill that out. Members, you kind of know what to do, but our guests, we're grateful that you're here with us. If you don't mind sharing some information, and then on the other side, there is our communion statement and those kinds of things. It's pretty self-explanatory there. If you don't mind, please just write the name of everybody in your group, and then if you're going to take communion with us, please just check off the box there, and we can place those cards. There's a number of trays in the back, and if you get a chance, you could do that in the midst of the service or certainly at the end. As we gather for worship this morning, there's a question that kind of ties our lectionary readings together, and the question is this: how shall we pray? That question is the focus this morning, and Jacob, as a model, our prayer might seem to be a struggle with God's will. And Jesus' parable in our gospel lesson this morning teaches that prayer is a long-term effort, but prayer is more than just a monologue. Our epistle reminds us that God started the conversation with his word. The Spirit has used that word and sacrament to awaken and guide our faith, and so it's appropriate for us to partake of the Lord's Supper today. Within that relationship, prayer is a conversation that goes back and forth, begun by God and continued each day of our lives. In worship, we do that with our brothers and sisters in Christ in kind of a corporate setting, which is what's going on here today. Moving from individual concerns to the concerns of the whole church, the body of Christ here on earth. And in worship, we take time to listen as God accuses, and rightfully so, but then excuses us, forgiving us all of our sins for Jesus' sake. And so we pray and we worship together, and we'll take a look at that in our worship this morning. So as we begin, let's rise, and we'll begin in song with thy strong word.
Thank you.
You may have noticed, but just so you know, this candle is lit. It just happens to be in the place where the cool air comes and hits your pastor in the face. And so if I'm standing over here, there's a reason for it, right? But it is lit. And once the air turns off, you'll see it a little brighter. God has called us to worship this morning, and so we begin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord God formed the man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
And the
thus says the Lord God to these bones.
Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live.
And when Jesus had said this, he breathed on them and said to them,
receive the Holy Spirit.
All scripture is breathed out by God, and it's profitable. Confident of his grace and mercy, let us confess our sins to our Heavenly Father. Merciful Father, we confess that we have erred and wandered from your ways like stray sheep. We have followed the desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your laws. We have left undone those things we ought to have done. We have done those things we ought not to have done. We cannot help ourselves. O Lord, have mercy on us. Breathe new life upon us. Teach, reprove, correct, restore us through your word, that we may live in praise of your holy name. Friends in Christ, in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus, the Word made flesh, all your sins were atoned for. All your sinfulness is forgiven. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We continue with the introit. Remember your congregation, which you have purchased of old, which you have redeemed to be the tribe of your heritage.
Remember this, O Lord, how the
do not deliver the soul of your dove to the wild beasts, nor do not forget the life of your poor forever.
Let not the downtrodden turn back in shame. Let the poor and needy praise your name.
Have regard for the covenant. Arise, O God, defend your cause.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Remember your congregation, which you have purchased of old, which you have redeemed to be the tribe of your heritage. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, almighty and everlasting God, you have commanded us to pray and have promised to hear us. Mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may direct and govern our hearts in all things, that we may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The congregation, please be seated. We continue with our Old Testament lesson this morning.
Good morning. The Old Testament reading is Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 through 30. The same night Jacob arose and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream and everything else that he had. And Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day has broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, saying, "For if I've seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered." The epistle is 2 Timothy chapter 3, various verses. "As for you, continue what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is breathed out of God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. I charge you in the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now, out of honor for Jesus, who is the Christ, we rise for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. He said, "In a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him saying, 'Give me justice against my adversary.' For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, 'Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice, so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming.' And the Lord said, 'Hear what the unrighteous judge says. And will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
The congregation, please be seated. We continue in song this morning, our sermon hymn, Children of the Heavenly Father.
Thank you.
Let us join our hearts in prayer. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, for indeed you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As we get into our gospel lesson from Luke this morning, we remember the well-known miracle from last week as Jesus healed those 10 lepers. They lifted up their voices, crying out, "Master, Lord Jesus, have mercy on us." And of course, Jesus, because he is a good master, because he is a good Lord, indeed had mercy on them and healed them. And we remember that there is one leper who happened to be a Samaritan leper, an outsider, in addition to being an outsider because of his leprosy, who came back to give thanks to God for what he'd received from Jesus. And there's an excellent point there about the kingdom of God being for unclean people as well as clean people, which is good news for us, because guess what? We'd be considered unclean. Yeah, this is true. This is true. And what's the point of all of that? The point is that the kingdom of God, the reign of God, is in our midst in the person of Jesus for the cleansing of the world, which is exactly what our Lord is doing throughout his ministry, cleansing the world, removing sin, dealing with it once and for all. That the bride of Christ, the church, the people of God would be presented holy, blameless, without stain, wrinkle, or blemish. And we are. You just heard it moments ago. Your sins are forgiven. So in Luke 18 this morning, we hear Jesus telling another parable about the kingdom of God to the effect that we should always pray and not lose heart. Is that easy? Isn't it hard to pray and pray and pray for things when you don't necessarily see the results of your prayer? You ever lose heart? We heard St. Paul speak this way recently in our epistle lesson too, citing prayer is something that we should do. It's of utmost importance. And it's something that we should do first. Talk to God. Talk to God. But as Jesus engages this subject this morning in the audience of mixed company in Luke 18, there's disciples there, there's Pharisees there, there's a draft pick to be named later. He's preaching about the need for us to understand, first of all, that we are all sinners and we are in need of forgiveness. And the one thing that you can do to make sure that you don't get the benefits of it is to not believe. If you don't want the benefit of the forgiveness of sins, don't believe. And it's important for us to remember, too, that here in Luke's gospel, we are on the way to Jerusalem where Jesus himself accomplishes and distributes the forgiveness of sins for you and for me and the entire world. And so as we pray, it's imperative that we not lose heart. Because the God we worship is good, he's gracious, and he's full of mercy. He not only hears our prayer, but he's answering it now, even if we cannot see it. And so to illustrate this reality, Jesus tells a story about a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. This would be somebody who's in charge of justice, who cares absolutely nothing about justice. Have you ever known any of those people or heard of any of those kind of people? They exist. How this man became a judge is a mystery, but what's not a mystery is that this guy should have been a judge. No, he should not have. Not no way, not no how, but he was. He's one of those crooked judges who is only interested in using his position to meet his own personal needs, his own self-interest, taking care of himself. That he was crooked this way is no secret, at least in the story. But regardless, a widow came to this judge, a woman who had no means whatsoever of self-sufficiency, and she kept going to him over and over and over, asking for justice against her adversary. Which is certainly not a bad way to see the situation, but the Greek word here is edikaio, which comes from dikaios, which if you're in the seminary is just fruit for the ears. You love that kind of stuff. But what it means is justification. She goes to this judge for justification over and over and over again through this crooked judge to give her justification, give her righteousness, give her goodness against her anti-dikaios, her unrighteousness, her unjustification. We see the word adversary, which isn't bad, but this woman has somebody who is trying to make her not innocent. This woman has somebody trying to steal her righteousness from her. That she would be guilty. And she's crying out to this judge for justification. Anybody see where this is going? This parable is really about our struggle with sin in our lives because we are in the same boat. We have an adversary. We have somebody who is trying to steal our justification, who's trying to take our righteousness from us. We carry around our sinful flesh. We carry around our mistakes, the things that we should have done but didn't, the things that we shouldn't have done but did. We have an accuser, Satan himself, who loves to dig up old bones, release the skeletons from the closet, even when God has taken them from us. So often we carry around things that have happened in our past that show how unrighteous we are, and we are powerless in and of ourselves to gain righteousness, to gain justification by our own efforts. And although we strive to be righteous with all that we are, we fall short. And even though we are God's people, and we most certainly are, new creations in Christ Jesus, we have Satan, our accuser, mercilessly pointing out mistake after mistake and shortcoming after shortcoming. And we know that to be true with the little things. It's even more significant with the big ones. The worst thing about it is we are by nature sinful and unclean. When we're accused, he's not wrong. We need justice. And when we confess our sins, we are literally going to the judge of justice. We are literally going to the judge of righteousness. Just like the poor widow, asking for justification, asking for righteousness, asking for goodness to be pronounced upon us, to be delivered to us, that we would be seen as righteous and holiness, whole and holy and justified. And every time we do so, it is. Because we're not going to an unrighteous judge, we're going to a righteous one in Jesus. But here in the parable, Jesus tells us that even the crooked judge will eventually give her justice. That what she is asking for, if for no other reason than to shut her up. Literally. Quit bothering me, okay. But the contrast here is that the righteous judge, God himself, will deliver justification quickly. Now. Completely. Continually. Without question. Every time we ask. And that's the judgment we receive. Not guilty of our sin. Not guilty of our unrighteousness. And we get to experience this gracious disposition every single time because Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. But even here in our worship, as our liturgy is composed to revisit this truth over and over and over again, That we could get it through our thick skulls, that the God we worship is gracious and he's just and he's loving. With confession and absolution and prayers and even our Lord's Supper, as Jesus comes to us this morning, offering us his body and offering us his blood, that we would be fed and nourished by his presence in our lives. Not just in a symbolic way, but in a very real, legitimate way. The justification, righteousness that we need and are asking for is here. For you. For me. Here we come seeking to be avenged, seeking to be judged, and we are not guilty. Because our guilt has been crucified with our sins paid in full on the cross of Calvary. But here's the kicker. And it's the very last question that our Lord asks in our gospel text this morning. When the Son of Man comes to accomplish this, is he going to find faith on the earth? Is he going to find his people clinging to this reality on the earth? Will Jesus, the Son of Man, find the faith that clings to God and God alone? As our righteous judge for the justice we so desperately need. You know what's interesting about childlike faith? It doesn't question. It simply holds on. That's what Jesus is asking. Are we going to hold on to this good news? Take it to the bank. When it comes to us and our fleshly humanity, the answer is decidedly no. But what's amazing is this, that when Jesus finds a lack of faith in us, he creates it by his grace. He creates it in his mercy. Here at this table, this rail, he creates it and strengthens it. He creates it and nurtures it in you. That you and I would be empowered to live by grace through faith in him, clinging to our righteous judge as he delivers justice without fail in the forgiveness of our sins. And as we live by grace through faith, that's where the ministry of the gospel is done, here, so that it can be done out there. As you and I are carried forth from this place to share this good news with all that we meet. That's where it's done to his church, or in his church, and that's where it's done to his glory. May God grant it. Amen. As we continue in our worship this morning, we rise and confess our common Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess to one another, I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We worship God with our tithes and our offerings. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your providence, your gracious hand that provides daily bread, provides justice, grace, and mercy. And as we worship you with our tithes and our offerings, Lord, we ask that what we bring would be pleasing in your sight. Use it to accomplish your good and gracious will, the world in which we live, all to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends in Christ, let us pray for ourselves, for the church around the world, and for all people in their various circumstances. As he wrestled with God, Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." For all people for whom prayer is difficult, that the Holy Spirit would enliven them with the reminder of God's promises in Scripture to hear and answer the prayers of all who call to him in Jesus' name. Let us pray to the Lord. As the woman in Jesus' parable was granted justice, even from the unjust judge, for all who deal with long-term ills, discrimination from the rest of society, the ongoing lack of food, clothing, and shelter, that the Holy Spirit revitalize them to pray without ceasing, confident in their trust of our gracious God's care and concern, let us pray to the Lord. As the church relies on the scriptures which Paul wrote, make faith-filled hearers wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus, that God would breathe new vigor into all who proclaim the gospel so that many may come to faith and grow in it. Let us pray to the Lord. As we go about our various callings in life, let us pray for those who protect and defend our nation, all who work for peace around the world and in our neighborhoods, people who supply goods and services throughout our nation and in our local areas, the professionals and volunteers who try to meet the needs of their patients and those who instruct and those who learn, that God the Holy Spirit would equip them for good works, using Scripture to teach, reprove, correct, and train them in righteousness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray. Heavenly Father, through your dear Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Friends in Christ, in this meal, our righteous judge comes to you to feed you with his body and his blood, in with and under these common everyday elements of bread and wine, that you and I would be filled, forgiven, and equipped to accomplish those things that lie on the road ahead in our lives. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks for grace.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you not only have created us, bestowed on us the gift of faith, but are ever near to listen to our prayers and our praises and answer them. Hear us now as we prepare to receive our Lord Jesus in with and under this bread and wine. Forgive, renew, and strengthen us in faith, we pray, until faith is replaced by sight. Then gather us together with all the faithful that we may rejoice at the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom which has no end. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Friends in Christ, our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to all of them to drink, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, you are the only Son of the Father. In giving us your body and your blood to eat and drink, you lead us to remember and to confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom. Teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please be seated. Our ushers will invite you forward in just a moment. Thank you. rise for prayer. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for in this sacrament you have answered our deepest prayers and nourished us with the body and blood of your Son, assuring us that our sins are forgiven. Strengthen us thereby and accompany us each day that we may meet whatever the future holds with a sure and certain hope of one day joining all your saints in glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant to you his peace.
Amen.
Amen. We close our worship in song.
Thank you.
Congregation, please be seated. Again, thank you for joining us in worship this morning. It's good to see you. This place is always better when you're here, and so I'm glad you're here. If you haven't already done so, please pick up one of these. This is our announcement packet for this week. Everything going on at Life in Christ this week is located here, including our 5:16 prayer list and our daily devotional, Treasuring God's Word. There are a few things coming up in here that are highlighted, and so you need to have all of that with you. So pick one of these up. It's by either of the doors as we exit. Immediately following today, we have donuts and coffee, of course, over in the fellowship hall. And then Pastor Anderson is leading a Bible class. And Dennis Fry is also leading a Bible class. And we have our deaf ministry Bible class as well. So lots of opportunities to continue to be enriched by God's word. That's how we live and grow in Christ and encourage and reach others. So I invite you to stick around for that. We have a number of slides here. The LWML is asking for non-perishable items for Thanksgiving baskets, which are going to be donated. We needed to get that going. Collection bins will be located in the Narthex until November 6th. And so if you're out shopping, and please remember, remember less fortunate people in our neighborhood and community, and we'll put those things together and deliver those as an extra little gift for Thanksgiving. Trunk or Treat coming up 2 weeks from today, Sunday, October 23rd. And we need more trunks. We have a few out there, and we thank you for signing up. Please entertain the thought and follow through with that, because it's a lot of fun. Lots of kids dressed up, hot dogs, hamburgers, candy. Does it get any better than that? Yeah, not much. It might, but not much. So there's a sign up out there. We want to be able to arrange enough spaces spread out and accommodate everything, make it a good event. So please sign up and let us know you're coming. Realm is coming in November. It's actually live this week. And Pam has got a grin ear to ear as she, we're all figuring it out now and changing our portion over to the new Realm system. Everybody is in there, and by the time we get to November, we're going to be able to have you all download the app and be connected and all of that. So please keep us in your prayers. We feverishly work on that. That's coming. November 6th after church, we're going to have kind of a lunch and learn seminar. We'll feed you. We'll get you all squared away for that. Also, too, the Veterans Day concert coming up November 13th, so mark that on your calendar. And Stephen Ministry Training Class, we need to have 10 people. It helps even if we have greater than 10. To hold the class. So if this is something that you're interested in being a Stephen minister or would like to find more out about what they do, those kinds of things, that's coming up in May. Yes? Excellent. There's a pamphlet about it in the back of the seat back in front of you. Yeah. I don't get to sit in those chairs, so take one of those with you. All right. A fall celebration, of course, coming up November 5th for the ladies of the congregation. And that's it. Anybody else have something to say? All right. Go in peace.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Thanks be to God.
Have a great week in Christ.